And the next item of business is a debate on motion 13017 in the name of Jenny Minto on Legislative Consent Motion, Victims and Prisoners Bill, UK legislation. I would ask those members who are planning to speak in this short debate to please press the request to speak buttons, and I call on the Minister Jenny Minto to speak to and to move the motion. Up to 5 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This afternoon we are debating the motion that this Parliament should agree that the relevant UK Government amendments to the Victim and Prisoners Bill, which were lodged on the 17th of April 2024, should be considered by the UK Parliament. The amendments set up an infected blood compensation body and make provision for further interim compensation payments to certain infected blood victims. The Scottish Parliament is having to consider this motion at very short notice because the UK Government has only been able to table its amendments at a very late stage in Westminster. What happened to infected blood victims is a terrible tragedy, one which the Scottish Government has apologised for, and I do so again today. I want to pay tribute to the families and the support organisations in Scotland that I have had the privilege to meet over the last year. They have been resolute in their work to ensure the plight of their loved ones has not been ignored. Their dignity, focus and strength is something we should all learn from. The Scottish Government confirmed in its closing submissions to the Infected Blood Inquiry, chaired by Sir Brian Langstaff, that it recognises the strong case for provision of compensation for all those infected with hepatitis and/or HIV, as well as their bereaved relatives as a result of infected NHS blood or blood products. Given this context, I am supportive of the policy intent behind the UK Government amendments. These amendments will help enable the implementation of the inquiry's recommendations as set out in its second interim report. The inquiry has recommended that compensation should be provided by one UK-wide scheme to ensure consistency of approach, regardless of where in the UK an applicant lives or where they were infected. The inquiry also noted that a single scheme would allow for it to be established more quickly, allow efficient processing of applications, and ensure the scheme has the appropriate, consistent legal and medical expertise. The UK Government amendments therefore set up a new arm's-length body called the Infected Blood Compensation Authority, which will deliver the Infected Blood Compensation Scheme. This scheme will be funded by the UK Government, which is entirely appropriate, given that the victims were infected pre-devolution. The amendments contain provision for the arm's-length body to be legally established on royal assent, which should facilitate progress. Much of the detail of the compensation scheme, including eligibility and payment levels, will be set out in regulations, and I know that this has caused some concern among some victims. The Minister of the Cabinet Office, John Glenn, MP, wrote to me on the day the amendments were tabled. In my response, I have stressed the need for the details of the compensation scheme to be set out as quickly as possible. I have also emphasised that the Scottish Government should be fully involved and consulted on their plans. The inquiry's second interim report also recommended that further interim compensation payments of £100,000 should be made to certain relatives of infected people following the previous £100,000 interim payments made to infected people or their bereaved partners. In response, the UK Government amendments make provision for payments to the estates of infected people who have sadly died, as a pragmatic method of ensuring that family members of the deceased get some compensation reasonably quickly. Again, in my letter to the Minister for the Cabinet Office, I underlined that these estate payments should be made as quickly as possible. There is no doubt that the UK Government's last-minute lodging of amendments has left the Scottish Government in a difficult position with very little opportunity to negotiate changes. However, given that the amendments represent both a concrete step towards providing compensation to the victims of this terrible tragedy and ensuring that relatives who have received nothing or little so far receive interim compensation, I do recommend the Scottish Parliament consents. Much more will need to be done to get the compensation scheme up and running and to make the further interim compensation payments. As that work progresses, I will seek continued engagement with the UK Government to ensure that the needs of the victims are put at the centre and that it works for all victims in Scotland. I move the motion.
Thank you, Minister. I now call on Claire Hoggie to speak on behalf of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee. Up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. My committee's scrutiny of this LCM has been curtailed due to the bill being amended to include provisions affecting devolved matters only at report stage in the House of Lords. The committee sought evidence from stakeholders on these amendments, and they raised a number of serious concerns that some of the changes deviate from the recommendations of the Infected Blood Inquiry's second interim report. In particular, the submission from Haemophilia Scotland raised concerns that the previous requirement for the Infected Blood Compensation Authority, or IBCA, to be chaired by a judge of the High Court or the Court of Session had been removed. They were also concerned that appeal hearings would no longer have the option to be conducted in person, would be before the ICBA rather than an independent appeal body, and that the amendments would also appear to remove access to independent legal representation and support during an appeal. They expressed further concern that no provision had been made for the representation of members of the community on the IBCA. Respondents to the committee's call for evidence further argued that the IBCA should be accountable to Parliament and not a minister or department. They suggested there should be a clear, tight and agreed timetable to get to the point of operational delivery of the scheme. And on this basis, they were concerned that the amendments remove a three-month timescale from the bill. They highlight a lack of detail relating to compensation payments, specifically the circumstances in which payments would be held in trust and the possibility of repayments. They argue that the Chair should be responsible for all governance, management, structural, operational and organisational development, and that the existing support scheme in Scotland, SIBSS, should be kept separate from the compensation scheme and guaranteed for life. They make the case that support payments and compensation payments should be, in their words, segregated legislatively, and that hepatitis B victims should be included in the interim compensation arrangements. Finally, they have suggested that those infected and affected by contaminated blood should be involved in the establishment of the IBCA and should have input and a power of veto in relation to key appointments. Despite these concerns, Haemophilia Scotland noted it was nonetheless supportive of the amendments because of a need to get this legislation into place so that swifter progress can be made to establish a compensation scheme for infected and affected individuals. Meanwhile, the Scottish Infected Blood Forum said a balance is needed between getting legislation into place so that swifter progress can be made to establish a compensation scheme for infected and affected individuals, and moving at pace, and then getting it wrong with little possibility of retrospective changes being enacted once views and actions have been solidified. The SIBF concludes, "We finally urge the Health Committee to look at all the specific issues and inclusions outlined to aid the Scottish Parliament in passing the legislative consent motion for the relevant sections of the V&P Bill, while opposing those which are not in the best interests of Scottish citizens or devolution." In summary, the committee has concluded its scrutiny by recommending that Parliament agree to the legislative consent motion. However, we also intend to write to the UK Government to further highlight stakeholder concerns.
Thank you, Ms Hockey. And I now call on Sandra Shkohani on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. Up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you. I'd wish to draw members' attention to my registered interest as a practising NHS GP. Presiding Officer, the contaminated blood product scandal has deeply scarred our four nations. More than 30,000 people in the UK were infected with HIV and hepatitis C during the 1970s and 80s in what has been called the biggest treatment disaster in our NHS history. For many, the NHS brought blood products from suppliers whose sources, which included American prisons, often had extremely low contamination screening standards. Much of the blood was often contaminated with sexually transmitted diseases and other viruses commonly passed on through needle sharing. The contaminated products were phased out by 1985 when heat-treated products were introduced. It's estimated that around 3,000 people in Scotland were infected with hepatitis C through NHS blood or blood products through the 1970s to 1991, though some were also infected with HIV in the early 1980s. Many have since died, leaving behind devastated families. To those who lost loved ones or continue to suffer, the Scottish Conservatives offer their deepest sympathies. We are united in offering our sincerest condolences and unwavering support to all victims. It is beyond terrible that the NHS patients were given the contaminated blood and wrongs were committed at all levels. We now share the responsibility to right these wrongs. Therefore, I support the Legislative Consent Memorandum to the Victims and Prisoners Bill, which paves the way for the establishment of a single UK-wide compensation scheme to ensure a consistent approach, regardless of where in the UK a victim or family lives. Justice delayed is justice denied. It is incumbent upon us to process applications as efficiently as possible and to ensure all affected receive the support they need and deserve. Communication is important. We need to double down on efforts to encourage all in our country who have not yet come forward for compensation to do so. And this extends to families, even if their infected family member has since died. As we confront this dark chapter in our recent history, we must recognise the invaluable lessons it imparts, including the importance of dealing with any future failures in a manner where transparency, compassion and justice prevail. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Gohani. And I now call on Paul Sweeney on behalf of Scottish Labour. Up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The infected blood scandal is an appalling injustice, as we have heard this afternoon. Labour, we want to help ensure that justice and compensation for victims and their families is delivered urgently. Therefore, we will be supporting the Legislative Consent Memorandum today. However, this has been a matter which has required the government at UK level to be dragged repeatedly to deliver this justice. And this LCM, as tardy as it is another example of the government failing to adhere to the will of the UK Parliament and indeed this Parliament, because it has been a result of responding to late amendments tabled by my UK parliamentary colleague, Diana Johnson, and trying to water those down that resulted in this late timetable by it being tabled in the House of Lords on the 17th of April 2024. And it is bewildering that this continues to drag on as long as it has, given that the government at UK level has already confirmed that they fully accept that there is a moral case for compensation. Well, the Chancellor has said that this has been going on far too long and that justice delayed is justice denied, and that is why we have a responsibility to work as fast as we possibly can to resolve this. Indeed, former Prime Minister Theresa May announced a public inquiry back in July 2017, chaired by Sir Brian Langstaff, and the inquiry has been running since 2018. The final report is now due to be published next month, and an interim payment of £100,000 for victims and affected partners was announced in August 2022 based on Sir Brian's recommendations. Indeed, I first raised the case of my own constituent in March 2018 whilst a member of the House of Commons. Indeed, it is a harrowing testimony that I'm sure we have all heard as parliamentarians, our constituents' experiences, hundreds of people affected across Scotland, and indeed some of the most horrific experiences that many parents still carry with them to this day. Indeed, I represented the former Rockhill Hospital in Glasgow, which was the main hospital in Scotland that dealt with cases of HIV and AIDS during the 1980s epidemic. And as a result of that, we had many young children dying of horrific diseases in that hospital, and their parents having to helplessly watch their children die, often suffering originally from haemophilia, and thinking that the very medicine and the very treatments that they thought would help sustain them actually killed them in the most horrific way. We cannot underestimate the damage that has caused and continues to do across this country. The third reading of the Victims and Prisoners Bill on the 4th of December the government lost a vote on new clause 27 in the name of Dame Diana Johnson, a historic rebellion against the government. The vote was remarkable, and it was a remarkable victory for the victims of the infected blood scandal. The government at UK level is now obliged to do the right thing and take the steps necessary to bring forward a final compensation body urgently. But it has been clear that the recommendations, as outlined, have not been adhered to fully, and we do have concerns about that. We have heard from a number of stakeholder groups that have worked so hard over the years who have raised their concerns. The Hepatitis C Trust have said that the announcement has blindsided campaigners and the infected blood community. We are concerned about the remit of this new expert panel and its purpose and whether it may constitute yet another barrier to delivering justice. They must urgently clarify what the group has been set up to do, who is part of it, and how their advice will be made public. The Haemophilia Society has said that this announcement, which was made without any consultation with the infected blood community, raises more questions than answers. We do not know which experts are on Professor Montgomery's team, nor has their appointment process been publicised. We do not know the panel's remit or whether their advice will ever find its way into the public domain. So these amendments are, you know, maybe necessary on the part of the government to take some action on establishing the compensation body for victims of this injustice. However, the government amendments do not include a commitment to deliver concrete action within a set 3-month time limit. That is why it is so essential that whilst we approve this LCM today, the Scottish Government raises these concerns on behalf of stakeholder groups with the UK Government at the earliest opportunity, as will the Health Committee. And on that basis, I rest. Thanks.
Thank you. And I call on Jenny Minto to wind up. Up to 4 minutes, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I want to thank members across the Chamber for their contributions to this short but incredibly important debate. I would also like to thank the members of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee for their contributions to the discussion on the issue this morning. I am grateful for all the useful questions and important points that have been raised today, and I welcome the committee's proposal that they will write to the UK Government to set out some of the concerns raised by stakeholders. I know that all of us in this chamber want to put the needs of the victims of this terrible tragedy first. As a result, I hope we can all agree that the right thing to do now is to make concrete progress on delivering these arrangements for compensation. Those who have been infected and affected have waited for far too long to see progress made, and many of the relatives of those who have sadly died have received nothing or only relatively small amounts of financial support so far. As I have set out, the main part of the UK Government amendments delivers on the key recommendation of the Infected Blood Inquiry by setting up the Infected Blood Compensation Authority. This authority, which will be legally established on royal assent of the Victims and Prisoners Bill, will deliver the Infected Blood Compensation Scheme. The amendments also ensure that all those in Scotland will have access to the compensation scheme on the same basis as those elsewhere in the UK, and that many bereaved families will get the opportunity to receive interim compensation while the final scheme is being set up. Much of the detail of the scheme will require to be set out in regulations, and I know that this creates uncertainty for victims, but I will work to ensure that those regulations work for all of the infected and affected victims in Scotland. And in particular, in response to Paul Sweeney's point, I will be raising some of the points members have raised today with the Cabinet Office. In conclusion, I ask members of this Parliament to support the motion lodged in my name so that we can finally begin to make progress on providing compensation to all of those people who were affected so badly by this terrible tragedy that took place.
Thank you. Thank you. That concludes the debate on Legislative Consent Motion, Victims and Prisoners Bill, UK legislation. It's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is consideration of motion 13016 in the name of Richard Lockhead on the appointment of the Scottish Pubs Code Adjudicator, and I call on Richard Lockhead to speak to and move the motion. Minister.
Moved, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, and the question on this motion will be put at decision time. And I am minded to accept a motion without notice under Rule 11.2.4 of Standing Orders that decision time be brought forward to now, and I invite the Minister for Parliamentary Business to move the motion.
Move, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. The question is that decision time be brought forward to now. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. The first question is that motion 13015 in the name of Gillian Mackay on Abortion Services Safe Access Zones Scotland Bill at Stage 1 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we will move to a vote, and there will be a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system.